Hello everyone, I am Rajeshwari Moganti, professor at the Department of Biochemistry, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. Now today module what we are going to do is on the scanning electron microscopy and its applications in biology and medicine. This is actually in paper biophysical techniques on the spectroscopic as well as optical techniques, and the module number is 4. So just before we do scanning electron microscopy, just want to recapitulate the previous one. What we have done in the first module is a light microscopy, or also known as optical microscopy. Then we did TEM, that is a transmission electron microscopy. Now just difference between these two is that, of course, light microscopy uses the visible light, and transmission electron microscopy uses electrons. In scanning also we use the electron microscopy, and the wavelength that is used is different in both scanning TREM and light microscopy. And the medium is actually in TEM vacuum, whereas in light microscopy you should remember it is in the normal air medium. And of course the sensitivity, the resolving power is different. In light microscopy you only can see the cell and 200 nanometers, whereas in TEM you can do the up to 0.1 nanometer. But the reason why we have to do an additional technique which has evolved as the scanning electron microscopy. Okay, after briefly gone through the difference between light microscopy and transmission electron microscopy, now we are going to do the scanning electron microscopy. So if you really go see the types of techniques, the microscopic techniques, transmission electron microscopy, which we discussed in the previous module, then high voltage electron microscopy, which is known as HVEM, then scanning electron microscopy, which we are doing now, and then scanning transmission electron microscopy, STEM, which we are not going to do in this because it is out of the scope or the purview of this whole topic. So next one what we are doing is the scanning electron microscopy. So the other techniques what I would like to introduce is the terms are the TEM, of course, which we did in the previous chapter, then the high voltage electron microscopy and scanning transition electron microscopy. These two we are not doing because it is not under the purview of this topic. So we will do the scanning electron microscopy. So the limitations of the TEM actually had actually helped in evolving the new technique, that is the SEM. Now there are the drawbacks of this TEM. What are the drawbacks in TEM? That is, many materials require extensive sample preparation, so that you have to produce a sample that is very thin enough to be electron transparent. Therefore, the TEM becomes analysis a relatively time consuming process, and also the number of samples you can do at a time is very less. Therefore, the throughput of the samples is also very low. The graphene, a carbon nanomaterial, relatively transparent, is very hard, and just one atom thickness, and that is used in a platform which is on which the materials have to be examined and therefore placed, and this becomes actually single hydrogen and hydrocarbon atoms. The third limitation is the structure of the sample may also be changed during the preparation of the process. The field view of the is relatively small, and therefore there are a lot of problems that can cause that the region that has to be analyzed is not actually the actual whole sample. And therefore, there is a potential that the sample may be damaged, and by the electron beam. Also, particularly in the biological samples, you need to them have to have in the closest condition, or the structural want them to maintain the structural details as far as possible. The time you have taken out the sample from the tissue or from the specimen. Therefore, the main difference between TEM and SEM is based on their basic function. Whereas in case of the TEM, one can see the internal anatomy of the sample, while in case of the SEM, you see the surface morphology. This is one thing extremely totally different, the total print. Although you will see at high resolution both of them, but the SEM is meant for a cellular morphology, and then how the cell on the envelope you can see the membrane and so on, whereas the TEM is for the internal structures or the cell organelles. So the principle is that when the accelerated the electrons are accelerated, primary electrons strikes the sample and produces secondary electrons, and these secondary electrons are collected by the positive charged electron detector, and which again in turn gives into a third three-dimensional image of the sample. So these are the basic three fundamental steps on which the SEM is based. Next, so the technique in the SEM, technically the signals can be fed into a CRO, and then the image is amplified. So the basic two components are there in this. One is a probing system and the other is the display system. In the probing system, what you have is the electron beam is generated by the electron gun or any electron probe, and then that consists of a V-shaped hairpin tungsten filament, and this filament is heated, therefore the electrons are emitted and accelerated through the anode. So that is the probing system. The second system is the display system, and here as the electron beam, actually after the electrons are generated, it hits the specimen, and therefore there the many signals are generated, such as the secondary electrons, X-rays are generated, backscattered electrons are generated, and different types of signals come into the from the emanate from the sample. So the different signals which give different information. Now, for example, secondary electrons you use, they give the surface morphology, like in case of the SEM. But if you use X-rays, it can be used for the elemental analysis that I will be doing at the end of it, after we studying the whole SEM, how can we use the X-rays for the elemental analysis. The third one is the backscattered electrons, that also gives a surface topology in a more detailed fashion, not a 2D, but it gives a 3D picture. Now, what are the principle of the SEM, and how does actually SEM function? So the SEM functions on the principle of scanning the surface of the specimen. There are two types of electrons formed. The electrons interact with the atom and make up the sample to produce signals, and these signals produce gives the information about the sample surface topography and also composition, and these properties such as the electrical conductivity, these are collected. Now the SEM actually functions on the principle of scanning the surface of the specimen. There are two types of electrons. The electrons can interact with the atoms and make up the sample producing signals information, and also such as the electrical conductivity. So this is one of the specimens from our laboratory. We have done the Acinetobacter baumannii, which is a hospital infection, and these bacterial have a different morphology, and scanning electron micrograph of this bacteria shows this is published in the journal, the Journal of Clinical Microbiology in Reviews, and this actually shows you the magnification up to 318,000, and this you can see the cells of the bacteria structure in a surface morphology is been clearly seen. And I'll also show you next example. This is one more example that, see, I would like you to appreciate that we are only looking at the surface morphology. You have seen the bacteria in the previous picture. Now you can see that these are the pollens. The pollen grains have different structures, and then this shows the characteristic depth of the field of the SEM micrograph, and these are the pollens. So this is the schematic presentation which depicts different parts of the SEM technique, where you have a source, then you have a first condenser lens where the electrons will be condensed, and there of course there is a second condenser, and then there is an objective aperture, then of course objective lens, and where you keep the sample, that is on a slide. Now this is the third example I would like to show you, that these are the red blood cells. You can see the morphology of this the red blood cell structure is quite different from any of the other cells that we have seen, like in a bacterial cells, that you can see the concave structure is very clear. Now, when we compare the main difference between technically both between both SEM and TEM, if you see the operational mode in TEM is that only surface morphology, and here what you see is the transmitted electrons, and whereas here you see the reflected or the scattered X-rays, and also the resolving power is same. Slightly better in case of the SEM, it is up to 0.1 nanometer, and the medium of course is in case of the TEM, you have to have a low vacuum conditions, and in SEM you have a very high vacuum conditions you use, and whereas the voltage applied will be of course in both the cases different depending on the necessity. Now, this is another picture what I would like to show you in a comparison with the three techniques, all the three techniques, that is optical microscope, TEM as well as SEM, that the how the picture is being generated. So, the next topic is after the studying surface morphology, what is now important is to understand how we can use SEM for the elemental analysis. Now, this is elemental analysis is something to different, it follows a different methodology, that is a scanning electron microscope can also be used for elemental analysis with a different operational method. Now, this SEM microscopy is used effectively for microanalysis, and failure of the analysis of the kind of solids and inorganic materials. Now, the scanning electron microscopy is performed at a high magnification and generates high resolution images and precisely measures very, very small objects and features of the objects of the samples. Now, here what is the principle behind and how is it different from the normal SEM for the morphological, and then how is it different from the for the SEM analysis. Here what you are using is the when incident light the electron beam actually hits the atoms, the specimens, then X-rays are emitted, whereas in the previous one we are collecting the electrons. So, these scattered X-rays which are characteristic for the particular atom present in that specimen. So, you are actually using it for the chemical analysis or the atomic sample analysis, qualitative analysis, not only the quantitative features of the structure. The high velocity molecule molecular electrons beam that is cause the electron of the from the outer shell of the atom that is being used, and that gives out a electron with a lower energy, and now this electron which falls on the from the high energy source it loses energy after some time after hitting, and therefore it actually sort of annihilation takes place, and this energy is emitted as X-rays, and a special detector is used on these for the collecting the X-rays. Now, in this each element contains electrons in orbits with particular discrete energy levels. Okay, so the X-rays collected by these detectors are analyzed for energies, different kind of energies, and corresponding to these energies detected by the element to which the electron belongs can be identified. So, basically you are trying to analyze based on the electron that are collected, that which element it is coming from, which outer shell it is coming from. So, if the number of elements are simultaneously irradiated by the electron beam, then a spectrum is generated with X-ray energy of different energy levels. Now, this information on the types of elements, and therefore there is a concentration distribution that is generated, which can be obtained by analyzing what are the X-ray spectra which are generated. Therefore, the spectra can be produced with the help of either the wavelength dispersion spectrometer, or you can use a energy dispersion spectrometer. So, in case of the wavelength energy spectrometer, we call it as WDS, but here what we are going to study is the energy dispersion spectrometer EDS. So the applications of SEM are enormous, but particularly the elemental analysis has also attained a lot of attention and a lot of applications. Here one of the important one is the of course the morphology, but then the signal generated during SEM analysis produces two dimensional image and gives information, whereas in this chemical composition is used when we are using the EDS, that but orientation of materials making up the sample also can be studied. And the EDS component, see, the orientation of the materials making up the sample can be studied, and also the EDS components of the system is applied in conjunction with this SEM analysis. So you have both ways, you can get more information if you apply both the techniques. Now you also can be used to determine the elements in or the surface of the sample for qualitative information. So you have additional advantage of studying both the type of material, that is the qualitative, as well as the surface morphology. Now measurements, that elemental composition for semi-quantitative results also can be used. Then you can identify the foreign substances that are not organic in nature, and therefore the coating on the metal is required. Now this is one of the examples of the SEM analysis. This is a spectrum, that is what you see, X-ray spectrum from the elemental analysis of SEM. This spectrum actually shows the mineral which is taken from a reference that is being given there, and most of these peaks from the X-rays are given off by the electrons, and they come from different shells, like K electrons are there, K alpha, K beta, and so on. So the each electron which is coming from a different shell, that actually gives a different energy because that is hitting the sample and coming out. So this, it generates a spectrum, and therefore you can analyze the sample very well. Now with that, I would like to summarize the module, that what we have studied is to understand the scanning electron microscopy, its applications in biology, and the complex interaction of the sample and the accelerated electrons, and whichever is your specimen, it could be a biological sample, it could be a organic or inorganic sample, any metallic sample, any kind of structure can be, the surface morphology can be studied. And the SEM utilizes the electrons to show an enlarged picture through the spectrum. And the scanning electron microscope is also used to scanning the surface of the microorganisms, as I showed you, in bacteria or any other tissue. You can even do for tissue. I only showed the examples of cells, of different type of cells, but tissue morphology, skin morphology, you can do for anything, whether it's a graft or it could be a skin with different under different conditions, burn conditions or a natural, and so on and so forth. Principle of the SEM is also explained to you in this module, when the specimen is targeted by the electrons, how the spectrum is generated, and differences between TEM and SEM is also highlighted in a table for you. Then examples of SEM in biology are explained. Then EDS, which is uses the SEM for the elemental analysis to measure the elemental composition, both in semi-quantitative and quantitative method, pure competitive results. And therefore, you can identify the foreign molecules which are not organic in nature and could be any metal, any composition. Now the principles of the SEM for the elemental analysis is explained to you. The primary electrons arriving at a given detector position can be used to give the images which are collected on the, gives a topological and compositional analysis. And therefore in various fields you can use both in medicine and biology, even non-biological sciences can be used, but in this module I tried to make you appreciate the applications of SEM as well as the SEM in elemental analysis in biological systems. Thank you.